Good morning and welcome to worship at Coatesville. The sun is shining, there's no rain outside. Our COVID cases seem to be decreasing, so it's a great day to worship. So let's begin with our pre-service song, Here I Am to Worship. Acknowledgement of country. I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land where we gather and from where we broadcast today, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. I'd like to pay our respects to the elders past, present and emerging and pledge our ongoing commitment to reconciliation and justice for First Peoples and others in this land. Let's continue with our call to worship. Every day we meet with God, but Sunday is a special day, and this is a special place and a special community. And so we gather for our special meeting with God in Jesus, in excited expectation that our lives will be enriched and that we will journey into the week ahead as changed and ever-changing people. Let us pray. God of friendship, you are our life's companion, a guest in our homes, and our host in this place and all the world. May we always be eager for your company, and as we meet you here today, may we be open to your transforming presence. Amen. And let's join in our next hymn, The Power of Your Love. Welcome everyone, to those of you on Zoom joining us today, welcome to you, welcome to those people on the phone, and welcome to those people here in person. Whether you've been coming here for a long time or a short time, or from near or from far, you are welcome to worship with us today. Graham's on a week of leave. In fact, he's worshipping at Tacoba, uniting today with his wife. I'm Janet, I'm one of the leaders here. Today we'll be exploring some themes of our two Bible readings. We'll be exploring Zacchaeus, which is a well-known story for most of us, and we'll be also exploring the Thessalonians reading and talking about some spiritual friendships. So let's continue with our prayer of confession. Gracious Lord, who sees all, you know all that we hide in our hearts. We lay before you all the things that dishonour you and us, acknowledging the damage they cause. We turn from hate and greed and pride. We ask that you would restore us and renew us, transforming our lives by the words and actions of your Son, Jesus, and cleansing us with your Holy Spirit, through whom you make your home in us. Amen. and our assurance of forgiveness, the God who calls us still, cleansing our hearts and renewing our minds. We delight in knowing that we are forgiven and that we can turn away from wrongdoings, that we can start afresh today. In God's great love, we choose to live differently. For Jesus' sake, amen. And let's join in singing, Lord, I lift your name on high. Well, I believe Charlie isn't with us today, and in fact, I don't think we have any children, but we all have an inner child in us, so we can enjoy one of the stories that we've known for a long time and enjoy hearing about Zacchaeus again. Today, it comes to us in the form of a story, and so I'm going to read to you with some slides, Zac the Taxman. This is Zacchaeus, Big Zac of Jericho, a little man with a big heart. You might think he has always been generous, but he hasn't. This is Zac's story. Let's go back to the start. Here is Zac's old school class photo. Can you find Zac? Yep. That's him down the front. Zac didn't like school much. At lunchtime, he was never picked to play basketball. I'll have Dangerous Dave, Agile Aiden, and Incredible Iona. I'll have Jumpin' Josh, Airtime Ash, and Leapin' Luke. You can have Zac. No, you have him. Zac, you can be scorer. But worst of all, and I know this would never happen when we went to school, kids used to tease Zac. They would point at him and sing, "Snorty, snorty, Zacchaeus is a shorty." And then they would laugh a lot, thinking they were very funny. This made Zac sad. Then he got mad. And then he decided to get even. Zac came up with a brilliant plan. Because Zach was always scorer, he became very good with numbers. He said to the other kids, let me do your homework for you. And for weeks, Zach did everybody's homework until no one could do it by themselves. And then he started charging 10 cents for each sum. Soon, Zach had lots of money. No one liked him, but Zach didn't care. That's the story of Zach at school. When Zacchaeus grew up, he was so good with numbers that he became a tax collector. His job was to collect money from all the people in Jericho and send it to the king. Zach still wanted to get even with everyone who had teased him at school, so he collected a little bit extra. $1 for the king, $2 for me. $1 for the king, $5 for me. $1 for the king, $10 for me. One day, Jesus came to Jericho. Zach was so excited he joined the crowd waiting for Jesus. He couldn't see. He tried jumping, but because he hadn't played basketball at school, he couldn't jump high enough to see Jesus. He tried pushing, but no one liked Zach, so they wouldn't let him in. Zach came up with a brilliant plan. He climbed a tree. People pointed at Zach and sang, "Snorty, snorty, Zacchaeus is a shorty." Zach didn't care. He could see Jesus. Jesus came closer and closer, stopped right under Zach, looked up and said, "Zach, hurry down. I want to stay with you today." Zach no longer felt sad. He didn't feel mad or want to get even. Zach was happy. No one had ever picked him before. Everyone else was angry. "Oh, why did Jesus pick shorty, snorty, greedy Zach?" they grumbled. Zach said to Jesus, "I will give half of my money to people who are poor. And to everyone I cheated, I will give back four times as much as I took." Zach belongs to God's family, Jesus told the people. "Hooray," said everyone. "I've got a brilliant plan," said Zach. "Let's all go back to my place for lunch." So they did. So I think the story of Zacchaeus works on several levels. I think for kids, knowing that Zacchaeus is a friend of Jesus, even though he did so many things that were wrong, is an important lesson. But I think there's a lesson too for us adults in what Zac did when Jesus met him. So Zac expressed being one of God's family by costly restitution. He gave all that he had back to care for the poor. And I think that's an interesting thing for us, that when we get to know Jesus, that there is a cost sometimes. And Zach did it by paying back to the poor. So let's continue with worship. And we're going to cross now to Lynn for our Bible readings.
Yeah. The first reading is taken from the Gospel of Luke, Chapter 19, verses 1 to 10. Jesus went on into Jericho and was passing through. There was a chief tax collector there named Zacchaeus, who was very rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but he was a little man and could not see Jesus because of the crowd. So he ran ahead of the crowd and climbed up the sycamore tree to see Jesus, who was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to that place, he looked up and said to Zacchaeus, "Hurry down, Zacchaeus, because I must stay in your house today." Zacchaeus hurried down and welcomed him with great joy. All the people who saw it started grumbling. "This man has gone as a guest to the home of a sinner." Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Listen, sir, I will give half my belongings to the poor, and if I have cheated anyone, I will pay back four times as much." Jesus said to him, "Salvation has come to this house today, for this man also is a descendant of Abraham. The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." And the second reading is from Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 1 to 4 and 11 to 12. And both readings are taken from the Good News Translation. From Paul, Silas, and Timothy, this message is sent to the people of the Church of Thessalonica, who belong to God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. Our friends, we must thank God at all times for you. It is right for us to do so, because your faith is growing so much and the love each of you has for the others is becoming greater. That is why we ourselves boast about you in the churches of God. We boast about the way you continue to endure and believe through all the persecutions and suffering you're experiencing. That is why we always pray for you. We ask our God to make you worthy of the life he has called you to live. May he fulfill by his power all your desire for goodness and complete your work of faith. In this way, the name of our Lord Jesus will receive glory from you and you from him, by the grace of our God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
One of the strange things that happens as we get older is the chance to look back at our life and reflect on the many friendships and relationships that happen as we go through life. There are friends who come and go, relationships that happen, and then there's another group of spiritual friends. Spiritual friendship is more than an acquaintance. It's an ongoing relationship in which we nurture one another's souls. When we take on a leadership role, we seek to develop positive relationships with the members of the group we lead. And for the purpose of this message, I'm going to call these relationships spiritual friendships. In spiritual friendships, divine affairs and human affairs intersect in such a way as to create moments of grace. Although the Apostle Paul uses different language, he often speaks about spiritual friendship. He often refers to brothers and sisters in the faith. In today's reading, he is writing to his Christian friends in Thessalonica, who were in a spot of bother. He expresses deep appreciation and affection for these spiritual friends, his brothers and sisters in Christ. I too am appreciative of the spiritual friends I've had along my faith journey. These days, I'm fortunate enough to have any number of spiritual friends, some here in my Coatesville family, and some through my connections with the wider church organisations. They are friends who have celebrated my joys, offered a listening ear in times of grief, and have journeyed alongside me as I've addressed any number of life's tough questions. I'm grateful for these spiritual friends now, but the spiritual friendships I have in my life go back well beyond my memory. From the time I was born, there were folks surrounding me who who shared in transforming me spiritually. Having grown up in this congregation, and you're right, I'm not going to tell you when that was and how many years I've been coming, but I know that there's people out there that could actually work it out. Some of my spiritual friends are people who have been part of this church in the past, and some still here today. Through their interactions and friendships, they have reflected God's grace and love. In word and deed, they taught me about God's word in the Bible. They taught me about Jesus. And they stirred in my heart a longing for knowing more about Jesus. All of these folks are spiritual friends because they fed my soul. All Saints' Day comes up very soon, a mystery for me for some time, until I contextualised it into the modern day for me. On All Saints' Day, we celebrate the great cloud of witnesses whose bodies have left this world, but whose spiritual friendships have shaped and moulded us. For me, it's a day to give thanks for spiritual friends, living and dead, who have helped to shape me as the Christian I am today. I am who I am today because of who we were together yesterday. Let me introduce you to some of my spiritual friends. Let me introduce you to Laurel Conway, my very first Sunday school teacher. Laurel looked after the five-year-olds. She lovingly nurtured her class of little ones, greeting each one of us by name and showing an interest in us, especially when it was our birthday and we got to sit in the birthday chair. She taught us songs, some I still remember today, and told us stories of the Bible. Her faithful leadership of her prep Sunday school group reflected God's grace and love for all God's children, especially us as little ones. Meet Mrs. Raymond, Mrs. Thomason, and Mrs. McConkie. These lovely ladies led Girls Club, I think it was on a Friday night, and we would gather as a group and join in craft activities and games, along with an occasional outing. My Christmas candle standing in the pressure pack lid filled with plaster of Paris is long gone, as lots of Christmas decorations do. But I did manage to find something from my Girls Club days. It's my very first piece of cross-stitch work, and I laboured hard on that cloth that today I've placed under the cross on our worship table here. These faithful ladies showed me that belonging to a church community was more than Sunday school and church, and that God's love could be found in daily activities. Meet Don Raymond, a brave man who took on the prickly challenge of leading a group of teenagers each Sunday up in the top kitchen. Sometimes we teenagers were more focused on other things than learning about the Bible. Sometimes we asked prickly questions like teenagers can be inclined to do. But Don's patience and commitment never wavered as he faithfully led his group and challenged us with thoughtful questions in return. And it's okay, Don, I still remember what a covenant is. You mightn't remember the lesson, but I remember the teaching. From Don, I learnt that it's okay to have questions about faith. Some questions don't have answers. Don's commitment to his faith, along with his encouragement, helped me make my commitment to follow Jesus. I want you to know about Jim Snow, who also led a Sunday morning youth group. But Jim had a gift for producing biblical musicals. I was proud to participate in the choir of The Inn of Bethlehem, where the Christmas story was told from the innkeeper's point of view. Having learnt the music to perform it, I still remember a few of the songs. Jim's commitment to his faith and his willingness to give of his time to produce these shows and involve the youth of the church at the time help me remain involved in the church at an age when many teenagers drift away from formal religion. Let me tell you about David White, Tom Slater, and a host of other people who were part of Scripture Union, an organisation that runs beach missions, camps and theos right around Australia and beyond. From my earliest involvement in CSSM beach missions at Anglesey and Pambula as a child where we holidayed as a family, to camps with Tom Slater as a director in my teenage years, any number of young adults witness to their faith, giving up part of their holidays to spend time helping the next generation know more about a God who loves them deeply. I am grateful for these people, although by now there are only a few names that I remember. Such was the impact of Scripture Union on my life that when invited to join in leading camps, I jumped at the opportunity. I later went on to cook on camps and also to be a team member, and later again co-lead two beach missions, if you can call Echuca and Shepparton beaches, I'm not quite sure how that works. And even when I got mightily cheesed off with Scripture Union at one stage, there was John Hartnett, also involved with Scripture Union, who listened to my whinges, then patiently waited his time, and then invited me onto his camps to cook again. And I did that for a number of years. And through this wide range of leadership experiences, my faith continued to be challenged, stretched, and grown further. These are just some of the spiritual friends who planted seeds of faith in my life. Some of these friends are still here today, and some are part of the church triumphant. The Apostle Paul knew that he too was shaped by his spiritual friendships. In his second letter to the Thessalonians, there you go, Paul gave thanks to God for his spiritual friends at that church. He singled them out for praise because their faith was growing abundantly, despite the fact that they were facing a few challenges. Paul encourages these growing Christians to remain steady in their faith in spite of the trouble and suffering, and to persevere in doing good. Few things in life are more powerful than a person of growing faith. When someone is growing in faith, their life bears fruit such that you recognise God at work in them. But no matter how strong the growth in faith is, encouragement in word, action, and prayer can be strong motivation for all Christians. Spiritual friendship is a gift from generation to generation. Each generation receives extravagant grace and a divine call to share that grace with others. Laurel, Joyce, Joan, Don, Tom, and John. Through them and others, I am the Christian I am today, and I stand here today as a witness to my faith. All of us are eager for role models, especially children and teenagers, and I am grateful for the ones God gave me as I grew into the Christian woman I am today. I am grateful for the spiritual friends who walked in front of me and left giant spiritual footprints. The next generation is counting on you and me for extravagant grace and a growing faith. They need us to make large footprints so that they can follow in our steps. As we as a congregation seek new ways forward, wherever God may lead us, I breathe a prayer of thanks for those spiritual friends who have gone before me. And I pray that you and I leave footprints of grace and faith large enough for the next generation to follow. I pray that God will grant me the opportunity to leave a spiritual footprint large enough to be seen and deep enough to matter. Amen. And let's sing our next song, the Servant Song. Thank you. holy and eternal God, whose vision for humanity is justice, peace, and wholeness. By the presence of your Spirit, may our generosity flourish and our living hasten the advent of your vision. Amen.
Prayers for the people, let us pray. God of compassion, we thank you that the congregation members who have had COVID are recovering and able to pick up their normal lives. Graham, Cheryl, Jeff and David, Sally, Jean and Wynne, Norma, Richard, John and Joyce, Gwyneth, and people everywhere recovering from COVID. Be with Betty Meelan's family as they prepare for her funeral in November. We pray for those in our congregation who need your special care. Pat and Jeff Rogers, Don and Joyce Raymond, Alma and Kath Ford. And be with Gwyneth and Bob's son, Peter, as he comes through surgery for a brain bleed that was done this week. We pray that Corinne and Lauren enjoy their time together in Italy and travel safely, and that Lauren's course will go well for her as she continues her studies in Italy. Heavenly Father, be with all those affected by the flooding in New South Wales and Victoria, in Echuca, Rochester, Shepparton, and all those places who have been inundated. Be with those working with and assisting people with homes still in danger and where waters are rising and falling. Be with all students doing final exams, especially those in areas affected by flooding. We thank you that many students have had a normal year in 2002, able to attend school and enjoy time with their friends and teachers. Be with all teachers as they often work with extra duties and extra students due to the many vacancies and absences caused by sickness and low staffing levels. Loving God, be with all truck drivers as they deliver food and supplies. Be with the charity workers assisting with essential food supplies for those in need. We thank you that we are able to help those who come on a Friday to our own church community care, able to help them with food and for them to be able to discuss their own private situation. Be with our state and federal leaders as they make decisions to benefit the people of their own state and for Australia as a whole. All-seeing God, be with prisoners and refugees, the homeless, the elderly, the weak, and Australia's first people, especially those separated from their loved ones. May the government process many of the refugees who have been on temporary protection orders for over 9 years and offer them permanency so they can work and contribute to life in Australia and sponsor family members separated from them for many years. Loving God, may we value our spiritual friends in this congregation and outside it. May we show kindness, care, and love to our families, friends, and strangers in the days ahead. All these things we ask in your name. Amen.
And our final song today, may our lives speak of your love.
Thank you.
Go now and live by faith. Patiently trust in God's promised future. Live by God's teachings and let your love for one another increase. And may God give you grace and peace. May Christ Jesus make you worthy of his call. And may the Holy Spirit fulfill in you every good resolve and work of faith. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.